Narcissus had heard that he had met with Irene the previous night. My God. They wanted to know if I had perhaps said anything which might have upset or disturbed their daughter, he said. I replied in the negative. Afterward, he did not drive to San Juan right away. My talk with the girl's parents had disturbed me, he said. Perhaps I had said something unintentionally that might have upset this girl. March 23rd, the day of the assault, to talk to a priest in the rectory. He had also conceded that he had entered the sanctuary and knelt in a back pew to say his rosary. And he followed, he had been driving a blue and white 1956 Ford sedan. But he insisted that he had left Edinburgh at least an hour before the attack, returning to the pastoral house in San Juan in time to ring the 5:30 bell. As for his finger, which investigators had learned had been badly cut, he had a simple explanation. The day before he went to Edinburgh, he had gotten it caught in a mimeograph machine. Several priests later told detectives that Father Fate had not returned to San Juan in time to ring the bell, and that his finger had not been hurt until the night of the attack. Oh my God. They also recalled that Father Fate had been wearing the same clothes that said her assailant had on. Both she and eyewitnesses who had seen her attacker fleeing the church subsequently picked Father Fate out of a lineup. Pretty incriminating. But not infallible, of course. But people have been convicted unless. The investigators brought in the foremost polygraph team in the nation. The Chicago-based John E. Reed and Associates, whose founder had literally written the book on lie detector tests. During 2 days of intense questioning in a Holiday Inn hotel room that June, Father Fate was evasive and at times seemed to enjoy baiting his interrogators. When asked to suggest a question that the polygraph examiner should pose to him, the priest put forward one. Do you believe it is possible that you may have said something or acted in some way to cause Irene's death? To his own question, he answered, yes. The subject stated that he was referring to the harsh way he had treated her in the rectory the evening she had disappeared. The examiner noted in his report, without further explanation. After urging Father Fate to be candid about the crime, the examiner recorded that the subject in very deliberate and explicit words stated that there will never be any evidence turning up in the future in this case. Further, that without a confession on his part, there's not enough evidence in either of these cases to convict him, or that a good defense attorney could not tear holes in. The tests definitely implicated him on both crimes, read the report. The examiner was convinced that the subject was not telling the truth when he denied killing Irene Garza or attacking Maria Guerra. Lie detector tests can, of course, not be accurate, but this is all we have, so take that for whatever you want to take it for. In August, Father Fate was indicted for assault with intent to rape. Texas, on the north side of San Antonio, Texas Ranger Rudy Jaramillo kept a framed black and white photograph of Irene on his desk. It is a haunting portrait. She is young and beautiful, a half smile gracing her face, and sometimes it looked as if she were staring back at the detective as he pored over old witness statements and police reports late into the night. Jaramillo was one of eight detectives on the Texas Ranger's new cold case unit, which had, at the request of McAllen Law Enforcement, begun to reinvestigate the case that spring. McAllen Police Chief Victor Rodriguez hoped that the Unsolved Crime Investigations Unit, with the assistance of his own department, could solve the murder that residents still talked about. But Jaramillo had little to work with. DNA testing of Irene's clothes had turned up nothing new, and many people who were knowledgeable about her murder, including nearly all of the detectives who had originally investigated it, had died years before. He was fortunate that the 1960 investigation had been remarkably methodical and well-documented, but the case file did not answer some of the most basic questions that a jury would ask. Where exactly had Irene been murdered? What was she killed with? When was her body dumped into the canal? The clues lay in a neatly typed two-page letter that Detective Sadler received from the former priest in Oklahoma City. It recounted a few details that the man had gleaned during his time at the Trappist Monastery, and it named the priest whom he had counseled. Sadler read the letter over and over again. The priest took her to the parish house to hear her confession. After her confession, he assaulted her, bound her, and gagged her. But he couldn't make sense of it. Had Jaramillo had the opportunity to read what was written, he would have immediately understood its significance. He had spent thousands of hours learning the facts of the case, interviewing more than 70 people in places as far away as Mexico City. But Detective Sadler knew none of this. He had diligently exhumed hundreds of old newspaper articles and what meager police records still existed from the early 60s, yet he could find no murders that matched the details in the letter. No young women in San Antonio had been attacked in a church. No bodies had been dumped around Easter. Sadler had other work to do. He was in charge of San Antonio's backlog of 1,420 unsolved murders. He set aside his notes in the case and moved on. A few weeks before Thanksgiving, Texas Ranger Rocky Milligan stopped by Sadler's office to pick up some evidence in a case he was working. As he talked about the progress of his investigation, he mentioned that the Texas Ranger's cold case unit had been busy. It was amazing, Milligan marveled, how old some of the cases were. They've got one out of the valley that dates all the way back to 1960, he said. A woman was murdered on Easter weekend, and the main suspect was a priest. Sadler couldn't believe what he was hearing. He pressed Milligan for more details, and the Texas Ranger relayed what little he knew. Early that evening, Sadler stopped and talked with Jaramillo in a parking lot in the same small town where they both lived outside San Antonio. The two men had never met before, although they lived less than 2 miles apart. The two detectives talked until it grew dark, and as they compared notes, they agreed that their separate investigations were in fact one and the same. Nearly all cold cases stay cold. Witnesses die, memories fade, evidence languishes, or is eventually thrown away. Only a fraction of them are ever revisited. What small number of unsolved crimes that happen to spark the interest of detectives have no guarantee of ever being solved. The odds the key witness in a cold case would decide to contact law enforcement 42 years after the fact was extraordinary enough. That the case was being actively investigated at the same moment in the city where the witness mistakenly thought the crime had taken place was beyond anything that its seasoned detectives had ever experienced. There were times when I felt that Irene was pointing us in the right direction, Jaramillo says.